You're listening to Earth Changes Radio with your hosts, Rick Chicago and Steve Johnson on the Terraforming Earth Network.
Good evening and welcome, friends, foes, and assorted others, to another segment of Earth Changes Radio, formerly known as Terraforming Earth. Today is Saturday, March 4th, 2007, and this is your host from Albuquerque, New Mexico, Rick Chicago. Joined here with me is Steve Johnson from the other side of the world in Australia. We have an interactive chat room going tonight, and what we're going to try to do is we're going to each do a couple of news stories, and we're going to let the interactive chat chime in if they have anything that they would like to. So we're going to do something a little bit different here with internet radio and try something a little bit new and going in another direction. I'm known as EarthPlay. You can join us every Tuesday night. We're doing an impromptu Saturday night program here, but we plan to do a regular Tuesday or Wednesday night, probably both nights, here on paltalk.com in the government and social issues section. It's free, it costs you nothing. Just join up, get yourself a pin or a nickname, and come into our interactive chat room. All you need is a microphone if you would like to participate, or a good pair of speakers or a headset, and you're good to go. www.paltalk.com in the Ancient Observatory chat room. We should have our website up and running pretty soon. I have it kind of in the editor right now. So some of the stories we have for you tonight are climate whiplashes globally going on. I'm going to have a Fukushima update and solar updates. And I also want to chime in on the Trump fake news stories, the power vacuums, the deep state, and the new rising police state in America. But first, I would like to introduce you all to my co-host and my good friend, Mr. Steve Johnson.
Thanks very much, Rick. Rick Chicago coming to you live and direct from New Mexico. Well, things seem to be going very, very fast this year, apart from the way I talk. But I'm talking about politically, geoactively, and what's happening in the world. Things are changing so fast, it is almost impossible to keep up with all the news that means a lot to us as human beings on this earth. And I think that is what this radio segment called Earth Changes Radio is all about. It is all about getting to the crux of the important topics, away from the Justin Bieber and Dancing with the Stars garbage. We're going to hit you with some of the most interesting and some of the most important facts that we need to know about in this day and age, and especially in an age that is changing so quickly and so rapidly. It is really hard for the average person to keep up with all the news because we're not being told the news. That's partly of what we're going to talk about first, I believe. The fake news that we're being bombarded with. We're being told by mainstream media that everything we've been taught in the last 15 years about what's really going on in the deep state, in the big corporations, in the companies, we're being told that all of that's fake news and it's a conspiracy theory. However, what the mainstream media do not tell you, Rick, is that a lot of this stuff is not theory. It is actually provable. There is actually proof and evidence of a lot of this stuff going on, and especially with some of the stories coming out. Can you elaborate on what grinds you the most about this fake news bullshit that's coming out here?
Oh, yeah, Steve. It's really unfortunate because it has put us, the average citizen, and all of the people in our audience and our auditorium tonight, it puts us in the unfortunate position of having to share with the public the news that we can't get media, can't get from our own government, state representatives, things that are covered up by agencies like the EPA, and the media runs with that, fake news. We have always complained that the news doesn't go far enough, or they leave part of the story out, or they're slanted to one side or the other. I would actually argue to you, Steve, journalism, there's not much left in our society right now. It's more reporting and Barbie doll prompter reading and politics. It's what it comes down to. Follow the money. These are all very well-paid actors and speakers, And it leaves us, Steve, in the very unfortunate position of having to give the bad news. The people who are going to be the party poopers and who are actually considered to be the fake news. And we're actually the reporters, the citizens, the concerned citizens and taxpayers of our prospective nations that it ultimately comes down, bears down on our taxes and the public to pay for all of these things. So we're going to talk about facts, things that are going on in our environment around us that the media will not tell you. Fukushima has been a problem for 6 years now. It's getting worse. When the reading spiked to 3 times background average, all of a sudden you might hear a blurb on the news headlines, and that's the end of it. Mass animal deaths, that's the end of it. You never hear about it again. And as you well know, that we have spoken about this many times. Even our close friends and families, co-workers, even people that we respect, and when we bring up topics, they're completely oblivious to it. And there are other considerations, the fracking going on in America right now, the industrial waste in our water and our food. So we have a lot of problems, Steve, and that is my main problem, because I don't want to get belligerent, with the media, leaving us in the unfortunate position of having to put ourselves out there in the light. It's not as though we want to be standing on this milk crate, because I certainly don't, but these topics need to be discussed and brought to the public by someone, and unfortunately it's going to be left up to the citizens.
One thing I have noticed there, Rick, is a lot of these videos coming out now about the Trump protesters being pepper sprayed and, of course, going berserk. Well, they have a right to protest. We've always stood up for anti-war. We've stood up for the anti-corporations and the anti-big business and the war machine that is making profits from these wars and killing, obviously, a lot of innocent people around the world. We're seeing an extension of that, an extension of the drone program. We're seeing that with Donald Trump. But nothing really has changed. And indeed, the police forces that we used to look at during the Bush administration, we're now cheering them on as they pepper spray these Donald Trump protesters. We still need to be reminded that these are the same tools of state that are still working against us. Now, I haven't seen yet Donald Trump put up any radioactive monitors on the coast of California. If he does that, if Donald Trump starts to monitor the radiation coming into America, we can be convinced that he actually knows something is going on and he's doing something about it. But I have yet to see that. We haven't seen any change from the policies of Obama, from the policies of George Bush, to allow the people to be poisoned by the Fukushima radiation, which is now endemic across the Pacific. And of course, we know that the species of animals are just dying off in their millions. As we heard from Dane Wigington from geoengineeringwatch.org, that we're facing not a genocide, we're facing an omnicide, which is basically the killing of all life itself on planet Earth. And it is now going viral. I mean, that is starting to seep into not only the water, but the air, the actual oceans. It's killing off the plankton. And being the base food chain for most of the sea life on Earth, plankton, once that dies off, it's like killing the bees. It will have a chain reaction with the rest of the organisms, not only in the ocean, but on the land as well. We're going to see a chain reaction occur, if it's not already occurring now. But there doesn't seem to be much action. There doesn't seem to be much priority about going about that to try and stop it or try and reverse the actions that have been happening. And I can only put that down to we're seeing the same corporations in power during Obama. We're seeing the same corporations still in power and still getting away with the breaking of the laws and the destroying of our resources. We're still seeing that under Donald Trump. I would have hoped that he started draining the swamp. But it seems to me the swamp just got thicker, and the swamp just got murkier, and the swamp is now basically part of the state. And the two are indistinguishable between the administration itself and the powers that be, the lobbyists. We're seeing them still in power. What's your take on that, Rick? Do you see anything changing at all? It seems to be the same bullshit happening again.
Yeah, thanks, Steve. And I agree with you, but I have a problem with this draining the swamp. You can't drain the swamp if you're going to save the alligators and replace them with crocodiles. I'm not sure how that's going to work out. And what I do see here is that the Democratic Party has lost its leadership. It's actually a party in disarray right now. And the Republican Party isn't much better. Because if you recall, Trump actually beat the Republican Party. He beat the Democratic Party. He beat the media. But what I see here is a power struggle. The Democrats and the people who have been placed in the deep state government, these are people, Supreme Court judges of various federal courts across the country, EPA, CDC, very vital federal institutions, have been planted with lifelong appointees by these presidents. And now there's a power struggle in the deep government of these planted political entities, and there is a war. There's like a mafia war going on within the government right now, a power struggle and a vacuum. And unfortunately, Steve, what I see happening here is that void is being filled up with the police state and a growing military-industrial complex. They have really gotten their foot in the door, which we have not seen since the time of Abraham Lincoln and maybe since the end of World War II, that the military has such influence on our government. I'm not sure how I feel about that yet, Steve, but going back to Fukushima, we'll pick up Fukushima a little bit later here, because this doesn't need to be overlooked in any way, and it needs its own time segment, actually, so we can get into it in a little bit more depth. But I didn't want to move past some of the other topics, like protesters, the protesters and what's going on right now, the pepper spraying, and some... There's fault on both sides. See, I am a protester, have been a protester, even though I'm not actively a protester. But the moment that you pick up a brick and throw it through a window, light a trash can on fire, or harass somebody because you don't agree with them, taunt them, or fight or cause disruptions, you have gone beyond being a protester to being an agitator. So that's where I stand right there, Steve. Go ahead.
One of the biggest facets of the false news that I'm seeing and I'm hearing and I'm reading every single day, it just seems to be pumped and pumped and pumped more and more by mainstream media, is this Russians scare. Now, when we saw the Russians scare as soon as the Democrat nominee, Hillary Clinton, lost, they came out and said already, straight away, that, the Russians have hacked our democracy, the Russians have hacked our elections, and they start to make a big deal about any person, any congressman, any senator speaking with the Russians. Well, me personally, I would like to know that our leaders are actually talking to the Russians. When you don't talk to people, it brings an air of suspicion, it brings an air of inconsistency, it brings an air of, my God, what's going on with the world? I would like to know that our leaders are actually speaking with the Russians, and indeed speaking with the Iranians and the North Koreans, making sure that we have a stable planet for human beings to live on, that there are stable people in control, and these people are able and willing to come to the table and talk to each other as real human beings, down to earth, sitting at a table, one-on-one, talking with each other about their differences, about how we can make a more safer world, not how we can make a more suspicious world or beef up the military-industrial complex that wants, they really, really want a third world war, because not enough people are dying off quick enough. They're trying this depopulation garbage with all kinds of stuff, including the Deepwater Horizon, the event of the BP oil spill in the Gulf. Nobody talks about that anymore. That's still affecting millions of people around the world, including the marine life, including the ecological systems, the micro and macro systems that we rely on for as human beings. Nobody talks about that. But it's still poisoning people to this day, as is Fukushima. Indeed, as is Chernobyl. Is still causing radioactive fallout to fall in Italy, across Hungary, across many European nations. Why we don't talk about that? Well, obviously, it's a distraction. While we're talking about that there's even more nuclear power plants being built in very precarious places, and indeed, there's nuclear power plants leaking all over the planet. And nobody, Nobody, except a handful of people like yourself, Rick, Dane Wigington, Lauren Moray, and a few other people talking about this. This seems to be the most pressing story that we should be talking about on the front page of every newspaper, and yet it is being ignored, and I think it is quite deliberate. Instead, they push the bullshit narrative of false news, of the Russians are coming, the Russians are going to hack us, I lost my cat, let's blame the Russians. Blame the Russians for everything. While you're doing that, you're looking at the left hand, while the right hand of Hillary Clinton, who should be in jail, by the way. Let's face it, I remember the presidential debate, Donald Trump said the first thing he's going to do is put her in jail. Well, I'm still waiting for that, Don. What's going on?
Yeah, Steve, you're dragging me all over the map here from Russia to Fukushima. I still have problems with our relationships with Russia. As you know, during the presidential debate, Hillary Clinton many times was poking her eye or poking her finger in the eye of Vladimir Putin, who I don't think is bluffing or playing games with these people. And I guess by their criteria, I am not eligible to work in the United States government or the federal government because, Steve, this is going to come as a great shock to you. I talk to the Russians. I have had contact with them. I have spoken to them directly for many hours and have good relationships. I have actually talked to people in, believe it or not, of all places, Australia. Little-known places like China. So, I am one of the rare few people who have created blasphemy by talking to the Russians. But what bothered me the most here is during that presidential campaign is Vladimir Putin was the only politician talking on a global scale or a global stage about nuclear conflict. And he was very serious about that, Steve. I would urge people to go back to June of 2016 and look up Vladimir Putin's nuclear speech to the press. He was actually threatening global nuclear war, and he wasn't threatening to start it. He made some very strong allegations about the U.S. government, which I cannot easily dismiss. And after listening to Hillary Clinton, Steve, it really drove that point home with me. So I don't know if Trump will ease that tension with Russia. It doesn't appear as though we are. Russia made the unfortunate decision to place their country too close to our military bases that have them completely surrounded. That was just a rookie mistake. Anybody could have made that mistake, Steve, but the Russians did set up their country way too close to our military bases, which is kind of a provocation in my eyes. And then going back to Fukushima, you know, this nuclear industry that they tell people is the cleanest, safest, most renewable source of energy on the earth. We have over 440 of these nuclear power plants all over the world, Steve, and they don't even provide 20% of the world's energy. Pretty startling when they told us in the beginning that nuclear energy would be so cheap and so abundant that they had to actually have congressional meetings to figure out a way to get because it was going to be so cheap, to figure out a way how to charge people because the energy was going to be so cheap. As far as safe and renewable death by all, but nothing safe has ever come out of the nuclear industry. Actually, I believe that Fukushima is the world's leading and utmost global disaster. And this situation is going to get far, far more worse, excuse my bad English, than before it will ever get any better. We still are waiting for the worst of Fukushima to occur. And I look forward to talking more about this. Go ahead, Steve.
There was a story published online just recently about the death of 37 million bees in Ontario, Canada. They claim that this was planted right next to a GMO cornfield. Do you consider that this may be part of the Fukushima poisoning of the planet? Because the insects, they're the most sensitive. When we spray, like for example, insect spray, we spray some bug spray around the house. What we're actually doing is putting a low concentration of toxic nerve gas and nerve agent into our homes. Now, they're susceptible to the most minute concentrations of this nerve agent, and that's why these bugs are being killed, because they're like a thermometer, that's a gauge on how good the environment's going. When some part of the earth is poisoned, the first species to die off are the amphibians, or the frogs, that actually absorb these chemicals into their body, and all these poisons into their body. Do you believe that this killing off of the bees is GMO, or could it be related to the poisoning via the nuclear poison that is now enveloping our entire Earth? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, Steve, you know, this is not as easy a topic as it might appear. I would say yes, they're definitely being affected by Fukushima radiation, but it's much wider than that. In a recent study that they did, bees in towns and orchards and cities and in forests where they're tracked and they're studied, they found that the bees were dying not only of toxic pollutants, but also of aluminum poisoning and heavy metal poisoning. And it didn't matter how far off in the forest that they went or into the mountains that they went looking for these colonies and hives of bees, they found the same thing. So it's global. It's a global thing now instead of more regionally where we're spraying and causing economic danger. And it's not only just the Fukushima radiation. It's not just about the toxicity in our environment and GMOs, which are devastating, but it's our rapid climate shifting, the whiplashes that come along with that. For instance, the almost complete breakdown of our ozone because of highly charged radioactive particles that are destroying it from within the Earth's environment, and an onset of gamma rays and cosmic rays that are coming from deep space from the other side with a weakening magnetic field strength. So the ozone is breaking down. We're getting more UVs, more UUVs, more UVC, and other harmful solar radiation just from our own sun and background radiation. Simultaneously, through the layers of the thermosphere, the hydrosphere, the ozone layer that are all breaking down. As well as the magnetic shield, shielding of the Earth, the magnetic field itself. So the bees are under attack from every direction, it would seem. And another startling fact that, you know, Steve, that I just discovered recently, I would like to talk about the killer bees in our area, how they're exploding due to the record warm temperatures, but I recently discovered that most orchards, greenhouses, industrial food growing, and GMO, they all rely in bees. And they're raised in New Zealand and Australia, and they're shipped to the U.S. to use in indoor greenhouses and industrial applications and so on. But every 6 weeks, by law, every bee is destroyed. All colonies, all hives, be they domestic or wild, wherever they're found in nature or in agriculture, are by order of the EPA destroyed. So that even a wild colony living nearby these industries are actually sought out and destroyed. And then, of course, the whole process starts over again. They reorder new bees, new queen bees. These are now being genetically modified, laboratory-grown, industrialized bees, much like the killer bees. But you know what? They're not having very much luck either, because once they're released into the environment, except in these bio systems like indoor growing facilities and greenhouses are exposed to the environment, and even in these environments, the outside environment leaks in and they're all killed anyway. So, and Steve, what do you know of the outbreak of avian flu worldwide being destroyed in country after country after country, and it not only being confined to avian but to swine? And I'm talking about swine avian flu, H1NH swine flu, where just yesterday 92 people died in China. Why are we not hearing about these things, do you think, Steve?
Well, very interestingly, the swine flu, the avian flu, that's something that we haven't seen in the news media much of in the last at least 5 or 6 years. But I'm sure it is still going on. It is still mutating, especially in places like China, where the overuse of antibiotics has caused a lot of people's immune systems to be broken down and to be not as effective as it used to be. 92 people dying? I certainly haven't heard that, but it wouldn't surprise me at all, especially in places like China, where, of course, the government doesn't want to talk about this, and they don't want anybody knowing about this, about how their systems are failing, because that's bad propaganda for them. You did mention earlier about the feedback loops that are happening. These are the climate whiplashes that are occurring. One point, the dam in California that burst, we saw some unprecedented rainfall in a place that is supposed to be completely devoid or going through drought at the moment. But we're seeing in places that have drought, a massive amount of water are falling. This is unprecedented. This kind of climate feedback loop, it seems to be affecting everything, especially the weather. One reason I've heard and read from spaceweather.com is in fact because of the sun's solar cycle that it's going through. Because of the sun's solar cycle itself, it is allowing a lot more background radiation into our solar system flying through the cosmos, and it is actually changing the amount of cloud cover we have, the type of cloud cover we have. It is changing the whole climate system itself just by the sun not having that effective magnetosphere or effective solosphere, I should say, the sun's bubble that protects us. Now I don't know if that is affecting directly or whether it's man who is changing that. When I say man, I mean the corporations. I don't mean you people at home who are forced to drive SUVs and forced to drive gas-guzzling cars and technology that hasn't changed in 100 years, defunct ancient technology that we're still using. But I do know that they're doing nothing about it. That's the big call for, let's bring in carbon tax and carbon tax and all these things. This is an Al Gore plan, that they want to tax the human beings for the things that the corporations are doing to the people. And that's where I think a lot of the problems on Earth are stemming from. They're stemming from corporations getting away with this. For example, in India, Coca-Cola have been draining the water from the local water supplies. They're now calling for Coca-Cola to be boycotted in India. Same thing's going on in Canada with Nestle. Nestle are stealing the people's water for cents in the mega gallon, and yet they sell it back to us for dollars for the liter. I mean, this is criminal action. We are human beings born on this earth. We have a right to the resources here if we're born here on earth. If we are earthlings, the earth is our combined home that we should all share, not put a fence up and make us pay through the nose for basic things like water, air, and clean food. We have a human right to water. Anybody tells you different, they're out to make a buck and screw the rest of you. That's how I feel. It's really, really sad what's going on. And this government is still allowing it. I mean, it is only, 2 months since Donald Trump was inaugurated? Or 1 month and a half? We're still yet to see any positive action from him. But how can he do his job when he's being mired down by all the bullshit about Russians and all the bullshit about everything they're trying to do to Donald Trump, take down everybody he places into a position? He can't run an effective government like that, not with these attacks coming left, right, and center from the people who have been butthurt because Hillary didn't get in. That's all it is. People who have been butthurt. We, as human beings, have a right to the resources. Corporations have no rights whatsoever to sell it to us. That's my opinion. We're right on the half-hour point right here on Earth Changes Radio, and we'll be right back after this short message break.
With over 150 million registered users, Pal Talk is the largest video chat community in the world, with over 300 Pal Talk support staff speaking dozens of languages to help you enjoy your online experience. Meet new people across town or country or continent while chatting about your interests. Sing live karaoke, listen to music, join a lively political debate, or play group trivia in one of thousands of chat rooms in various categories from your PC, mobile, or tablet device. Joining Pal Talk is free and easy. Go to paltalk.com and become part of our friendly community today.
Hi, I'm John Lennon, and you're listening to Earth Changes Radio on paltalk.com.
You're back with us live on Earth Changes Radio. I'm your co-host for tonight, Steve Johnson, joined by the very infamous Rick Chicago, and we're discussing everything that's happening this week in the Earth, on the Earth, and around the Earth that we live. I personally believe that a lot of these agencies, a lot of these governmental agencies that are causing and allowing the poisoning of our planet, I think they need to be made illegal or at least held accountable. Somebody needs to be held accountable for the poisoning of our Earth. I'd like to get opinions from EarthPlay. What is your opinion on banning the companies and the corporations and, of course, the governmental agencies and charging these people with crimes against humanity for poisoning the Earth? What say you, Rick Chicago, sir?
Well, I'm not going to be able to top that, Steve, but you know as well as I do that agencies like the EPA need to be abolished. Or reformed, and maybe we'll see that. And under the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency, which allows corporate pollution, hides it from the public and fines the public if they do the same exact thing. A lot of hypocrisy here is under them is the BLM, who take our lands in the name of the people, put up fence even in our national forests and places like the Grand Canyon falls, fence them off and sell them to corporate or foreign interests for uranium mining, which is going on to take the lumber or the minerals or whatever is on that people's land that has been put into the protective trust of the BLM. The Department of Bureau of Land Management, fencing it off and keeping the public out, resources. Another thing, Steve, and I'll try to be quick about this, is that Donald Trump spoke about making America great again, restoring patriotism and pride in our country. But yet, I have yet to hear him say anything about constitution-free zones, which exist over 50% of the population, unknowing to the population. Constitution-free zones. He must abolish that, but he's not going to, because he's using that constitution-free zone that covers 50% of the largest cities in all of America to enforces immigrants. So I see an enhardening, actually, of the police state and an erosion of our Constitution. And this is blatant. This is blatant. How could he not know this? He most certainly does know this. And I think that if more people were outraged or even aware that they live in Constitution-free zones in America, that they would be outraged and we would get rid of this. It's only been around since 1972 or so. But, I have found it to be very, let's just say, disruptive to my lifestyle in rural America, because they don't like people in rural America. They don't think anybody belongs out here in rural America, that this belongs to them. And I never see them until they come out with their little shiny trucks with red police lights. They don't live here, but they think that they own everything and they control everything. So I have some real reservations, as you do, Steve, with some of these intergovernmental agencies and Trump's failure to recognize our concerns out here in the public.
You know, the very interesting thing you just mentioned there, Rick, is the police state surveillance system that Donald Trump inherited. He, of all people, should know that that is the number one enemy of the American people, a system that is allowed to blatantly and openly tap into people's phones, tap into people's houses, tap into people's lives, record people from their computers. Even Mark Zuckerberg covers up his own laptop for fear that somebody's going to listen to him or record him without his knowledge. Now, the interesting headline I saw this morning is Donald Trump's claiming that the NSA, or in fact Obama, has actually been tapping the White House and listening to Donald Trump, especially during the elections. Now, he's seeing the direct result of the NSA PRISM spying program. That's what that is. That there's no way to get around it. And until he dismantles that, we don't have any basic human rights to privacy in America, in Canada, in Australia, in New Zealand, or any of these places, especially in the UK, where the whole thing is completely CCTV'd everywhere you go, everywhere you walk, especially exactly through Europe, everywhere. Until the day that he dismantles that spying network, which is almost intrinsically built into the internet itself, the very code we use. It was released just recently, the PHP code that is used in websites is an Israeli invention. And of course, the facial recognition companies being bought up that were designed by Israel are now endemic everywhere around the world in all the systems that governments are using to spot people, to facially recognize you, to put your thumbprint on your phone to unlock it. All this biometric data, what are they doing with it? You've got no idea what they're doing with it. That's the problem. They could be doing anything they like. They can stitch people up any way they want with these digital dossiers they're keeping on people. And of course, that's what they're going to do. They're going to easily be able to stitch anyone up anytime they need with this information. And I think until that is dismantled, I'm not going to hold any hope that any president or any senator or any congressperson has actually got the American interests at heart. We are definitely living in a police state, and if anybody doubts that, if anybody has any doubts about that, just look at what Edward Snowden came out with, the exposures of WikiLeaks that we're seeing. A lot of this stuff is talking of stuff that we've known all along, that we've known for years, but now it's been confirmed that they're doing this on a massive scale, and it needs to be reined in, it needs to be shut down. This system of snakes in a plane, snakes in your home, the snakes are the NSA, and they need to be shut down immediately, effective immediately. That's my first presidential order. Go ahead, Vice President Rick. Go ahead, sir.
Thank you, Steve. I'd like to remind everybody and welcome you all to our first impromptu interactive radio program for Earth Changes Radio with Rick Chicago and Steve Johnson. We're interactive on paltalk.com in the Ancient Observatory, and we have a few folks in the room tonight. And one of our covenant advisors that is usually present in a lot of our chats, it says here in his text, "The Constitution is a worthless piece of paper, and it always has been." And I know that a lot of people feel that way and they think that way, but the Constitution is more than just a piece of paper, at least to people like myself. I can't speak for you, Steve, or for our interactive guest auditorium, the people in our chat room tonight, but it's a collective idea. Truth seeker, and I didn't want to drop your name in public, but let bygones be bygones. It's a collective idea. We want to have a free and representative government. We want to be left alone. We want to have privacy without our televisions watching us, our computers reporting our activity, our cell phones tracking us wherever we go. We just want to be peaceful, to coexist. I don't think that many of us want wars. So the Constitution is a lot more than just a piece of paper for a lot of people, and it is for me. What do you think about that? It's a pretty controversial topic. We'd like to welcome Ben to our radio program. Flag burning. I'll tell you, Steve, when I see somebody burning an American flag and the ideals that we collectively want to have for our country, it infuriates me, and I'm going to get a bloody nose every time I see somebody burn a flag. So you may feel differently, but go ahead, Steve.
Well, these people who do that, they can burn cloth all they like. It's not going to stop other people believing in it. It's not going to stop the ideals on which the foundation of that was formed. But interestingly, when we talk about the Constitution, I always remember some bonehead they call Baby Chimp, Chimpy Bush, saying the Constitution is just a goddamn piece of paper. If you remember that, that was our president at one stage, saying the Constitution is just a goddamn piece of paper. And that in itself should have been enough for him to be done on treason. Should have been him to for him to be thrown in jail for even saying that. You know, in my line of work, you got to keep repeating yourself to kind of catapult the propaganda. And that's what it is. They catapult the propaganda by repeating it again and again and again. By saying this, that the Constitution has no worth, it has no rights. Well, you keep saying that, people are going to start believing it. You start putting in into Supreme Court justices pieces of garbage like Ruth Ginsburg. You start putting these 2% of the population into large positions of power in the government. This 2% of the population, well, how are they representative of the majority? The first step to getting towards the kind of society that you want is visualizing it. The first step to making a better America is if you can start to dream and imagine a better place. If you can visualize that, if you can see a better place, if you can see Hillary Clinton in jail being touched up by Large Marge, then you can actually start to believe and start to know that that reality is going to happen. We create reality with our thoughts. Combined reality, well, that just has a lot more power to actually make it true. You won't get to a free and better and open society with rights of privacy, with rights of human rights, with everybody, unless you believe it is even possible in your lifetime. If you sit back and say, well, you're just dreaming, guys, you won't ever see that, well, then, of course, you won't see that. But you got to start believing that there's a better place. And the first step towards getting to that place is knowing that it exists. It exists. You believe it exists. Well, guess what? That's the first step to bringing down the wall that is stopping you from achieving your potential as a human being. We all have potential, and indeed, we're seeing a lot of potential in a lot of human beings these days. No matter what the naysayers say, we are the ones we've been waiting for.
Okay, and that is an introduction to our topics tonight, and they're all, as you can see, very controversial, but Steve, we left one out. There was one topic that we did not hit on. And we're going to get into all of these topics just a little bit more deeply, show you the resources, give you the links, point you in the direction where you can get some of this information and examine it for yourself. You don't have to believe us or anyone else. Just so long as you're out there looking, examining, and discovering the world that you live in for yourself and finding out the truth. And the truth is not always palatable for most people. When you find enlightenment, as I have found recently, it comes with a great price. You have to shatter your illusions or long-held beliefs when you discover truthful information. So enlightenment can be very disturbing and very distressing, and it's not for everyone. But Steve, we left out one topic that we didn't cover, and I see that some of the chat participants are ready to come up here with their comments and questions. But what about the transgender issue? Is the one that we did not talk about when we were highlighting our topics for tonight. But we do have, before we get to that, yeah, we do have someone from the auditorium coming up to the mic. Lady of Wisdom, you're next. What's on your mind?
Okay, this is Jacqueline in North Dakota, Standing Rock. My nickname was Runaway Grandma. About 4 years ago, I thought I coined the word planetarian. I said, first and foremost, I'm a planetarian. My obligation, responsibility is to nurture this planet and my planet mates. Not everybody living on this planet is my planet mate. So, you know, I respect you with the American flag, but I just found out that someone has designed a flag, a Mother Earth, and I want to get one. Because if we don't live in peace, we're going to be in this planet will be in pieces. Off the mic.
Well, absolutely right, but I do consider we're already living in pieces as planet Earth. We are already fragmented. We are already subjected to that kind of labeling and that kind of compartmentalization of people, putting people into little boxes that we can actually discuss. Well, they're one of those. I know exactly what they're about. We already live in that. That's part of the design by Edward Bernays that designed the way our system is today. And of course, the gentrification, the new Mr. Rick Chicago was talking about, the idea that you can choose what kind of species or what kind of gender you want to be assigned as or noticed as or recognized as. This is going too far. A girl in Norway wants to be known as a cat. I mean, come on. You're born a human being for sure. Aren't you part of the human race? This woman wants to be known as a cat. That's how far and how stupid it's getting. Apart from having gay marches in the streets where people are running around topless and having dildos hanging out everywhere, that's pretty sick shit. When I think about that growing up, as you know, 30, 40 years ago as a kid, we would never see that on our main streets. That kind of thing is just not the sort of society I want to see. But now it's not only just people believing that they are a subspecies and wanting to be identified as a subspecies or a subgender or their own gender. How many genders are we going to have? How many genders do you really want to have on Earth? When I grew up, there was just two. But we're now seeing the politicizing of sexual identity. And that politicizing of sexual identity is very, very dangerous for a society. It just increases or decreases the morals of that society. There's another guy, I don't know if you saw the article there, Rick. Another guy wants to be known as an alien. He spent $50,000 on turning himself into an alien being by gender remodification, by all kinds of plastic surgery and all kinds of garbage like that. How far is this going to go? What kind of species do you really want to be? That kind of garbage just goes against everything that it means to be a human being on this earth. We were born into the perfect form that we are. And indeed, to change it that way and that radical just shows that people are not happy even being born a human being. If you're not happy being born a human being, hey, get off the earth. go and expend your body to the empty vastness of space. Well, I shouldn't say empty because, as we know, space and vacuum certainly is not empty. It is full of everything, all kinds of elements, all kinds of plasma, electrical charges. Space itself is wonderful. It's an abundance of elements, and it's an abundance of all kinds of life and all kinds of fantastic stuff we have yet to even discover.
Yeah, I can't touch that topic, Steve. All I can add here is people should keep it in their bedroom. There's no real reason that I should know about it, that it should be on the television, the billboards, the magazines, advertisement, pamphlets on my car, parades in my street. Unless you're hitting on me, there's no real reason for me to, you know, even have an opinion here. But I will say that if you come and knock on my door and you ask me to endorse, to sign a petition, or to vote for your cause, and I disagree with you, it does not make me instantaneously your enemy. Because, as I say, what you do in the privacy of your own home is your own business. And for me to, when you bring it to me and demand my participation or my approval or my opinion, and you don't agree with it, you don't like my answer, well, sorry about that, but it doesn't make us enemies. You know, each person should live their life according to, you know, their own spirit, their own set of morals, values, principles, interests, directions, studies, adventures, explorations, you name it. We have them all. So that we don't agree, it just chaps me, Steve, you know, for lack of a better analogy, it just chaps my hide that this is such a divisive topic, that if I don't fall, you know, directly in line with these movements and these transgenders and these snowflakes, and I'm sorry if you're offended by these terms, these college triglets and say space, you know, today I'm a cat, tomorrow I'm going to be a leopard, and the next day I'm going to be a man, and, you know, it's none of my business. I don't need to know. You know, why are you putting it on the front page of the magazines, the television, advertisements, pamphlets on my car, for Christ's sakes, parades in my streets? So I have kind of a problem with that. The same thing would go for politics. The same thing would go for religion, or motocross racing, or horse racing, or fishing. So these topics are just superficial to me, Steve, and I don't see how they actually have anything to do with me, unless you're hitting on me or you're seeking my endorsement. I just say, c'est la vie.
Very well spoken there, Mr. Chicago, sir. Very well spoken. I agree with everything. There's nothing I can pull you up on that. The one thing I would like to know is these people who identify themselves as a subspecies, like a cat, well, are they eating cat food? You really want to be a cat? Well, here you go. Here's some kibbles. Come and get them. Come on, precious. These precious petals that are so offended by all this garbage. Like, oh, I'm offended. I'm offended. You're so offended. Wear diapers. Wrap yourself in bubble wrap. Stay in your home. And please, don't mix with the rest of society. You know, we don't want to know your stupid shit. We don't want to know it. Post it on your blog. Let everyone laugh at you like that. But honestly, stay away from the rest of us. You know, do us a favor. Now, those people with that kind of mental derangement syndrome, and that's the only way I can classify it, who the heck would want to remove their own genitals to become an alien? What kind of food would an alien eat? Well, you can't go to your supermarket and buy alien lasagna, for example. So what are they going to eat? Is this woman going to eat tuna for the rest of her life? Or should I say tuna? What kind of stupidity is that? Well, I do believe we have a caller here that is willing to come up and call us. Please tell us, caller, your first name and whereabouts you're from, and then your question.
Okay. I had to step away. Hubby wanted something. But Earthquake, you brought up the Constitution, and then I'm going to address Ruby why it offends me. Earthquake, most people don't realize our Constitution got suspended when Roosevelt signed the New Deal, which also implemented the Federal Reserve. When you start digging further, that's my only way of summarizing when Bush said it's only a piece of paper. And Ruby, the reason why this unisex stuff offends me, because now, because of your rainbow agenda, as I like to refer to it, the flood has come out in the open and it's all clear. I don't feel I should have to answer if I'm a transgender, a heterosexual, gay, lesbian, whatever, male or female, is enough information, because now they have extended it to my medical forms. That's bullpucky. Because what I share between me and my own doctor is our own business. Because we have come in a computer age. Anything can be hacked into. That's what I don't like. Okay? Well, I scrolled back up. This is what offends me on that topic. Because now this issue is delving into other things, which eventually I could see. And I had to play devil's advocate at the doctor. EP, your mic.
Well, as you can clearly see, we have a lot of issues and problems in our society. And don't forget that we're an engineered society. All of us were born into this system geared towards feeding a society. So we're all engineered. We're all products of our society and our environment. And there's a lot of different opinions. But we're getting to the end of our hour, of our show here tonight. And we invite you now to come to the microphone. If there's anybody that would like to chime in on anything that we said or would like to be part of this segment, our first inaugural Earth Changes Radio program, we invite you to come up to the mic right now. Everybody, hey, thanks for participating, being patient, and putting up with us tonight. Steve?
Well, sir, the last thing I'd like to add is, of course, if we're allowing gay parades on our street, why do we not have heterosexual parades? Oh, that's right, because if you walked around topless with dildos hanging off you, you'd be arrested for public indecency. But apparently, if you identify yourself as some kind of rainbow fruit, you're allowed to do that. Yeah, you're allowed to do it. You're quite allowed to walk around completely naked, pretending to engage in sexual congress in the middle of the street. That, to me, is wrong. It should be one law for every people. Not just because you happen to identify yourself as something a little bit different, you're allowed to behave in a certain manner, but that the powers that be are allowing this to degrade our morals. And I stand with Russia on this. I stand with Vladimir Putin saying that this is an agenda. Even Disney are now coming out with Beauty and the Beast, the movie, with some gay character, Gaston, or whatever he is, coming out as gay in a kid's movie. I mean, for shit's sake, in a kid's movie, that kind of thing should be illegal to allow that. And let's not forget, the whole story of Beauty and the Beast is about a woman falling in love with an animal. That's basically what it is. And if you kiss that animal, it'll turn into a handsome prince. What are we teaching our kids? What kind of influence is that having on the young minds that are growing up that need to be basically given better things than that? They need to grow up as kids, not as little human beings that are being exposed to something that is inherently wrong and inherently against the natural process of human beings. I find that astounding. But nevertheless, it is Disney Corporation, and it is another corporation, yet another corporation, as well as Coca-Cola, as well as Starbucks, and Disney, and L'Oreal, and Revlon. It's another corporation that is funding the illegal state of Israel. So it doesn't surprise me at all that they have this agenda to manipulate and twist the minds, the young growing minds, into something that is abnormal to make it normal as they're growing up.
Thanks, Steve. And we couldn't coax anybody to come up to the microphone and participate. But let me invite you, if you've made it this far into the audio, and we're coming to the end, I'm going to congratulate you right now for putting up with this and getting through the entire audio. And we would like to invite you to join us in our live chat room, our interactive chat room. And there's a lot of people in here right now, and they're texting, and it's not always pleasant, but we try to keep a friendly, clean environment. We would like to invite you to paltalk.com and join us in the Ancient Observatory on Tuesday and Wednesday evening, when we'll try to bring you up to date what's going on around you in the world with weather phenomena, disasters, earthquakes and volcano activity, changing processes of the Earth's climate. We have a lot of topics, including the political clusterfuck that we find ourselves in, Steve. So there you are. Thanks for listening to our video stream, Earth Changes Radio, every Tuesday and Wednesday night here in our interactive chat room. Anything else you'd like to add, Steve?
Well, sir, I'd like to thank everybody for listening in and of course, remind everybody to subscribe to the channels that you see these videos on. And indeed, please come and join us. We love talking about this stuff, and we're going to get more information out. That every day there's more new headlines. We could talk for an hour on just about every single headline we see. But, of course, we have to wrap up the show today. The first inaugural Earth Changes Radio with Rick Chicago and Steve Johnson coming to you live and direct across the planet and in real time and across the world. Thanks very much for listening. Take care. And, of course, stay safe and ciao for now.